Hello YouTube, Mikey Cal here, and this is video number one in my new series on utilizing Blender as a video editor. Now, if you want to hear about the history of Blender, please do watch the previous video that I did that in 2 minutes sums up how Blender became an open source, free to use video editing 3D modeling program. But I'm guessing that most of you just want to get to the editing already. So this video is going to cover setting up all the defaults so that we can open up the program on a regular basis and just get right to it. So first things first, we're going to actually take our mouse and we're going to click in this middle section so this dialog box disappears. And what do we see initially? We're looking at the default layout, which is a 3D view. That's because the primary function of the Blender program is a 3D modeling function. But we want to actually use the video editing functionality of this program. And how do we access that? Well, we actually have a layout drop-down right up here. You can click on this drop-down, and you can see that we have some pre-configured layouts. We're going to go to the last one in that list. It's video editing. Now, this is actually set up pretty well by default. Let me actually just break down each of the components that we have in front of us. This section over here is the preview window, and when we actually play back our video in the sequencer, it will actually show us a sample of it. This section over here is actually the curve graph editor, and this is used actually for doing transitions, like if you want to control the speed of how a fade happens. This is something that we're going to be doing a little bit later in the tutorial series because it's a little more complicated, but it is really awesome when you start using it. This right here is our sequencer, and this is where we set and import all of our source video files, and we sequence them, or we put them in an order, and we cut them up, or edit them, or do whatever we want to do to the video. It's all done here in the sequencer. This down here is the timeline. Now the timeline is really designed to be used with this curve graph editor. It will allow us to actually do something called keyframing. And keyframing is an awesome way to do transitions. This program can utilize keyframing on most of its components. And it's really complicated for me to talk about it right now, but I will explain it later and you'll see how cool it can actually be. Now down here we actually have our bar that actually controls the playing of the actual preview. We're going to actually now go to this drop-up box, that's what I like to call it, and it controls what we actually see in this window right here, over here. So I'm going to click on that and I'm going to change this to a properties window instead of a graph editor. Okay, so these windows that we're seeing right now are pretty much what we want to have on a regular basis configured by default. This section right here is actually the properties that's the properties window that we use to actually configure the resolution, the frame rates, and all other things related to the video. So it makes much more sense for us to be able to access this stuff on a regular basis than to access the graph editor, though we can bring the graph editor up at any time. So what we're going to do now is we're going to set all the default settings and in the properties. So we're going to first go to the dimensions area, and they have a little drop down right here called render presets. And what that does is it automatically configures our video properties to these standards. Now I'm actually going to be recording in HDTV 1080p, but if you're doing 720p or some other format, select that and it will automatically switch the X and Y values for you and make it so that the video is actually going to be output at the correct resolution. Now I'm going to actually do 1080p, so let's select that. So you can see 1080p has a resolution of 1920 by 1080. Now this section over here is our start and our end frame settings. This is basically a video is made up of frames. And typically, depending on the type of video, you're going to have a certain number of frames per second. So typically on YouTube, for example, a video is recorded at 30 frames per second. So we need to take into account how many frames we're going to actually have in our video and set the end frame to encapsulate that amount of the amount of frames that we're going to use. Now you can change this on the fly by actually typing in any number here and hitting enter, or you can actually click on this with your left mouse button and drag it, and that will change it. And you can also change it down here where it says end down here. You can do the same thing. Highlight over it with your left mouse click and drag back and forth, or just click it and type in the number. And this right here represents the frame that you're actually on. So we're going to set that back to 1. Okay, so I just set this to some random number. It doesn't really matter. We can change it on the fly, as I said. Next, we're going to actually try to set our frame rate. And I said typically I'm going to be doing YouTube stuff, so I'm going to be doing stuff at 30 frames per second. So we're going to set that here. Now, you have to remember to set this frame rate setting to the identical frame rate of whatever your source video file is. And the best way to actually see what the frame rate of that file is to get a program called VLC. And VLC actually has a option in one of the menus that's called a media codec option that will actually tell you everything about that video, from what resolution it is to what frame rate it's running at. Now we're going to go down. We've set our resolution and we've set our frame rate. And I'm going to go down, and whenever we actually make a new AVI file, or the file that we're actually going to output after we do all of the editing in the sequencer, we need to know where that file is going to go. And by default, it's going to go in temp. I'm on Linux right now, so it's going to go in slash temp. But on Windows, it will go in SQL and backslash temp. And Mac, it's some version of slash temp as well. But we can make this anything we want it to be. So I can just click on this by clicking on this little file folder right here. And I'm going to select a location on my computer that I think is a good place to put these videos when they're done. So I'm going to go into my videos folder. Put it anywhere you like. And I'm going to hit accept. There we go. So now we have a location where our resulting video, when we click the animation button to render it, it will put it in my video folder or wherever you want to put it. Next thing we need to do is we need to actually set the file format that we want to output our final video in. By default, it's actually set to a picture, but we want to set it to one of these movie formats here on the right. I just clicked on here, and for the sake of this video, we're going to do all of our movies in Xvid format because it tends to be the most tried and true format. It just tends to work cross-platform most consistently. So let's just select that for the sake of learning. Okay. Now we're going to select RGB because we want color in this. And I'm going to go down to this little section and click encoding right there. And we're going to set some of our presets. And we're going to set this preset to Xvid as well. Okay, and we have a bitrate set of sets to 6,000 right here for the video. That should be fine for any high quality video that we're doing. Should be no problem at all. It should look great. The next thing we want to do is set our audio, because we're going to also encode audio with this video. And by default, it's turned to none. It will actually produce a video if you render it right now without any audio. So we're going to click on none, and we're going to switch this to MP3. And now, when we render this video, it will actually have video, which will be in AVI and Xvid format, and it will have audio in MP3 format at 192 bitrate. Okay, so the one thing that I passed over is we want this to render in the background, so we're going to switch the display to keep UI. And this is just to it reduces the amount of CPU time needed to actually render. It's not going to render it to the screen and render it to a file. It's just going to render it to a file, period. So it's more optimal for low-end systems, but it works great on high-end systems too. So that, I think, should actually do it for our properties. But we want to actually change a couple things down here too that will actually help us improved how the playback looks in this window. So let's go to the playback menu, and we're going to select audio scrubbing, and we're going to select AV sync, and we're going to select frame dropping. You can see the check marks next to each of these three things. These things will improve the performance of the playback video. Audio scrubbing will basically make it so when we actually highlight and click our left mouse button and pull over here, it will actually play the audio with the video in real time. The AV sync is so that the audio and the video synchronize, they do lip syncing, you know. And frame dropping is an actual feature that if your computer is having a hard time keeping the audio and the video in synchronization, it will drop video frames to make sure that it continues moving forward and stays in sync. So those are the three settings you want there. Now, what we want to do is we want to set this to frame one, because that's our beginning frame, and this is the, you can change what current frame it's on by clicking in this little thing down here and typing one. And you see the green line will be on one now. Okay, so that is all that we need for the properties and for the preview playback. Let's actually go to File, and we're going to save this as our startup file. What that's going to do is it's going to save all the things that we just did as the default. So let's click on that, and it will offer this second dialog box. Let's click it again. There we go. Now, if I close this and I reopen, it reopened, and you can see all of our settings that I set are all set exactly. So you'll be able to actually just come right in here and get right to the editing. You don't have to worry about configuring other than changing the frame rate if that's necessary. Now, there's some other things that I would like to also point out that will optimize your performance. Now, not everybody should set their settings in their preferences to the same settings, but I want to provide, I want to show you guys the preferences settings that can improve your performance if you want to play around with them. So let's go to File, and we're going to go to User Preferences, and we're going to go to System. Now, the one thing that we're going to use in video editing that's going to be really helpful in improving the performance is our prefetch frames. Now, I have a i5 computer with 16 gigs of RAM, and my performance is pretty good. And I like to turn this all the way up. I turn it all the way to 500. What that's going to do is it's going to actually prefetch as it's playing back each of the video frames so that and pre-render them so that it will decrease the amount of slowdown. Now, the problem with that is on a lower-end system, you're going to be doing CPU frame, you're going to be crunching the frames, you're going to be working at the frames, and it may slow down the general performance of a lower-end CPU. So I set that high because I don't have any issues with it. Now, your memory cache limit is also very important. This is the amount of memory that Blender is going to reserve for using, you know, to increase the performance. I always set this, I have 16 gigs of RAM. I set mine to about 10 gigs. Now, I would never, don't set it all the way to the top. Play around with this actual setting, because you may discover that some settings work better than others. I'll set mine to 10. I just clicked on it, by the way, and with my left mouse button and dragged. So I'm just dragging it up to 10, and that works well for my hardware. But I would say if you have 8 gigs of RAM, maybe turn it up to 4. That could work well. Try it out. These settings can be played around with just to get them right. So I'm going to actually now, I have my prefetch frame set to 500, and I have my memory cache limit set to 10 gigabytes, basically. Save user settings, and we're going to actually close this down. And that should do it. From this point on, you guys should be able to open this up and get right to the editing. And I'm going to start talking about actually doing some importing of video source files in the next video. See you there.